بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال تعالى أيضا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Allah the Almighty to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost I advise myself and then all of you all present here, let us introspect ourselves. Let us examine ourselves by instilling in our hearts, by permeating our lives with taqwa. And that is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives, bearing in mind that after exerting ourselves or whilst exerting ourselves to the maximum in terms of adopting taqwa, we are not supposed to entertain any thoughts of self-righteousness. Allahu Akbar. This is our deen in a nutshell. We are supposed to exert ourselves to the maximum in terms of acquiring taqwa, in terms of adopting taqwa in our lives, but taking precaution, taking heed that we do not entertain thoughts of self-righteousness. We should not think that, oh, I am a pious and righteous man. Look at that individual, he is a sinner. Or, I made it to the masjid for Salatul Fajr. I prayed behind the imam, right next to the muadzin. I know of my friend who is snoring away at home. So I am more pious, I am more righteous than that individual. Allahu Akbar, this is a quality from the qualities of shaitan, and that will result in kibr, in arrogance filling our hearts. We must never ever entertain thoughts of self-righteousness. On the other hand, we should pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because none of us can guarantee that we will be people of taqwa until the last moment, until the angel of death comes in front of us. None of us can guarantee. So we should keep praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, make me from the people of taqwa. Ya Allah, keep my heart steadfast upon your deen. Ya Allah, let me not deviate. Let my heart not deviate. Let us keep praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and let us not become proud and self-righteous. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from pride, and may He the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the topic for today's khutbah is insha'Allah ta'ala, every dark cloud has a silver lining. This is the topic for today's khutbah. Every dark cloud has a silver lining. It is an idiom. It is a phrase that goes along the lines in terms of its meaning, that however difficult the situation may be, whatever trial or difficulty you're going through, remember or know for a fact that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. However dark the skies may be, or even if you look at a dark cloud, you would notice that every dark cloud has a silver lining, in the sense that a new day is going to break out and make those dark clouds vanish away. So let us not lose hope. Let us have hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and let us keep our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we look around today, when we look at the world today, we see disturbing scenes, we hear disturbing pieces of information, we see so much of carnage, we see all of these atrocities that are taking place through the hands of these brutal oppressors and tyrants. We see so much of disturbing scenes. We see that wherever we look, whether it be international or whether it be local, if we look at the law, if we look at justice, if we look at the rule, if we look at administration, all of it has been contaminated by oppression. It has been contaminated by corruption. It has been contaminated by nepotism, etc. All of it has been contaminated. If we scale down to our own personal lives, all this while I was talking at an international level, at a global level, if we scale down to our own personal lives, each and every one of us is fighting our own battles. We are all fighting battles from within. Each and every one of us, we are going through different trials, different calamities, different misfortunes. And that's why I said in the beginning that it is not upon us to entertain thoughts of self-righteousness, nor are we supposed to be swift in judging other people. We are not supposed to judge other people, because like I said, all of us are fighting different battles from within. Each one of us is going through a different test that perhaps you and I cannot at times recognize. So like I said, if you make it to the masjid for Salatul Fajr, don't think, oh, this brother didn't make it for Salatul Fajr, so he is a sinner. At times some people go a step worse and they say that he has been destined for Jahannam. I am the Jannati, he is a Jahannami. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. Let us purify our hearts. Let us not think ill of our own brothers, because let us make excuses for them. Let us give them the benefit of the doubt. And throughout the khutbah, insha'Allah ta'ala, I will be repeating a phrase in the Arabic language, that is, La tahzan. La tahzan, do not grieve, do not become sad, do not lose hope, do not despair. So at times I might repeat it in the Arabic language, and I don't want you all to not understand that particular phrase. La tahzan, in the sense, do not grieve, do not be sad, do not lose hope, do not despair. Because optimism is something important, extremely important for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thinking positive. Because our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the greatest optimist this earth has ever seen, or this earth has ever witnessed. Allahu Akbar. He was never ever a negative individual. He was an extremely positive individual. And I recall the words of a wise man who once said that a nation is very rarely destroyed by a physical combat. A nation is very rarely destroyed by a physical combat. But on the other hand, a nation that is subject to a psychological defeat, a nation that is subject to a psychological defeat, a nation that has become victim to a psychological defeat, there is a high possibility that that nation may be erased from the pages of history. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. Let us not lose hope. Let us not become victims to a psychological defeat. Coming back to an international level, you look around, you look at the atrocities taking place in Gaza, in Palestine, and other parts of the world. The Muslim Ummah is being battered. But yet we are not supposed to lose hope. Let us not slip into an abyss of negativity. Let us not slip into an abyss of despair. Let us rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and let us be positive, because like I said, in accordance with the topic, every dark cloud has a silver lining. Let us not lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us make tawakkul. Let us rely upon our powerful maker, because just as how he eased the trials and calamities that people before us were put through, the same Allah, our beloved maker, our powerful maker, is with us. La tahzan, inna Allaha ma'ana. La tahzan, do not be sad, do not worry, do not despair. Inna Allaha ma'ana. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. La tahzan, do not lose hope. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, let us not lose hope. Let us not become negative. Let us be positive. Let us greet each and every day with a positive approach, as this is from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because the more positive we become, the more pure our hearts will become, inshallah ta'ala. And the more we rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, grief and misfortune will not attack us. Grief and misfortune will not befall us. Because whatever the trial may be, whatever the calamity may be, look at the instance where Abu Bakr radiallahu an, the Sahabi, great Sahabi radiallahu an, his daughter was slandered. Aisha radiallahu anha, his daughter, his beloved daughter, the beloved wife of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was slandered. And relatives, close people to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, they were also involved in the slander. They also spoke bad about Aisha radiallahu anha. People whom Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was spending on, he was looking after them, he was maintaining them, those very people spoke bad about Aisha radiallahu anha. But look at the magnanimity of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He forgave them and he did not stop the payments, he did not stop maintaining them. Because of the beautiful quality of forgiveness, he forgave them. Allahu Akbar. Now scaling back to our personal lives, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, when you look around today, there may be many people who may talk bad about you. There may be many people who may talk bad about you. They may not agree with you perhaps. They may talk bad about you. At times they may backbite about you. They may go around carrying tales about you. They may spread rumors against you. They may lie against you. Allahu Akbar. What is the difference when all of these things took place to the most beloved of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If it happened for the Anbiya alayhimus salatu was salam, why can't it happen in our own lives? If there are people who put you down, if there are people who hurt you, if there are people who have usurped your rights, if there are people who have cheated you, if there are people who have hoodwinked you, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, don't take it personal. Don't take it personal, rather forgive them, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Ghafoor, Al-Rahim, the most forgiving, the most merciful, will indeed forgive you. وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ.
وَلْيَعْفُوا, let them forgive, overlook. وَلْيَسْفَحُوا, let them forgive, let them overlook. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, do you not wish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should forgive you all? Allahu Akbar. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, and Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. Let us be merciful unto the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اِرْحَمُوا مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يَرْحَمُكُم مَن فِي السَّمَاءِ, be merciful unto the people who are on the face of this earth, i.e. the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَرْحَمُكُم مَن فِي السَّمَاءِ, and the ones in the heavens, i.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the malaika will have mercy upon you. Let us inculcate this beautiful quality of mercy. Let us adopt that from the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have not sent you except as a mercy to mankind, Allahu Akbar, to the creation, to mankind and jinnkind. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a mercy. Let us inculcate that beautiful quality, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, because that quality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that beautiful quality, that amazing quality, that quality was the catalyst that brought the people towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was that amazing quality that brought people to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah the Almighty states in the Noble Quran, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Allahu Akbar. If it was not for that beautiful quality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if it was not for that mercy, if it was not for that mercy, all of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in who had gathered around Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he were not a mercy, if he were not a mercy sent to them, and if he did not deal with them with merciful qualities, if he had been hard-hearted, if he had been harsh, if he had been strict with them, they would have all dispersed away from our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, let us adopt the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let us be merciful unto one another. Let us forgive one another. Let us be kind to one another. Let us think good of one another. Let us not put down one another. Perhaps you may differ with an individual. See, every man to his own opinion. Every man to his own opinion. We have not been created alike. We are all different. Maybe I may think of something, you may think the exact opposite. Allahu Akbar. You may think the exact opposite. Look at the A'imma rahimahumullah. Look at our scholars rahimahumullah. Look at the beautiful way they differed in their opinions. At times, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah would have said something. He would have said something, and Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah would have said the exact opposite of that same issue, but both of them respectfully disagreed. The two schools of thought respectfully disagree with one another. They don't diss one another. They don't put down one another. They don't disgrace one another. They don't go around spreading rumors about one another. Nor should we, because this is not from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not from the beautiful deen of Islam. Let us purify our hearts. Let us purify our thoughts. If we don't have something good to say, let us remain silent in accordance with the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we have something good to say, then we speak. If we don't have anything good to say, then we remain silent. Whether it be in the real world, whether it be in the cyber world, whether it be in any context, any platform, if we have good to say, then we open our mouths. If we don't have good to say, we remain silent in accordance with the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Coming back to the quality of mercy, let me narrate unto you all a beautiful incident. An incident that highlights the mercy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the beauty of the social interaction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A prophet the greatest of all prophets, Sayyidul Mursaleen, the greatest of all prophets, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the noblest of all creation, he had been shouldered with so much of responsibilities, but he made time for his sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, so much to the extent that each and every sahabi thought that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves me the most. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Which leader today, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, can emulate our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such a way that every single subject, every single follower thought that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves me the most. When he used to talk to them, when he used to address them, he used to focus on every single individual. Allahu Akbar. He used to focus on every single one of them. He wouldn't look at just one area. And at times, when we socialize in a way that we like to rub shoulders with celebrities. We like to rub shoulders with the rich. We like to rub shoulders with the famous. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to rub shoulders with the poor and the destitute. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray, Ya Allah, let me die amongst the destitute and resurrect me amongst the destitute, amongst the poor, amongst the needy. Allahu Akbar. Today, we take pride, oh, I know so-and-so politician. I know so-and-so minister. Oh, I have this contact number in my phone book. But in regard to the poor, in regard to the destitute, in regard to the disheveled, in regard to those who don't have any social standing, we don't even invite them to our gatherings. We don't even invite them to our functions. All against the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there was once a Sahabi radiallahu anhu. His name was Zahir ibn Haram. His name was Zahir ibn Haram. His name was Zahir. He was a Sahabi radiallahu anhu who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved very, very dearly. He was a Bedouin. He was a Bedouin who used to come from the outskirts to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And whenever he was poor, he was not a handsome looking person, he did not have a great social standing, he was not from the city, he was from the outskirts, he was a Bedouin, he was poor, he was living hand to mouth, he was just making ends meet. But whenever he used to come to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to bring a small gift, whatever it may be, for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever he used to come to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to bring some milk, he used to bring some cottage cheese perhaps, he used to bring some meat, something that was within his capacity as a token of love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved that sahabi radiallahu anhu dearly. He used to love him very, very much, Zahir radiallahu anhu. One day, and once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Zahir is our Bedouin and we are his city dwellers. Allahu Akbar. He is our Bedouin and we are his city dwellers. Once Zahir radiallahu anhu was in the marketplace, because he used to come from the outskirts, he used to bring things and sell in the market, make a small profit, and he used to go back to the outskirts. One day he was in the marketplace, he was selling some things, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whenever I read this narration, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I go green with envy in regard to this sahabi radiallahu anhu. I envy him so much. Allahu Akbar. Just listen to this amazing narration. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to the marketplace and then he sees Zahir radiallahu anhu in the marketplace. And you know what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did? He went behind Zahir radiallahu anhu and he hugged Zahir radiallahu anhu like this from behind. From behind tightly. Say if this was Zahir radiallahu anhu, he hugged him like this tightly. He hugged him tightly and Zahir radiallahu anhu could not see who was the person who hugged him from behind. So he was a bit worried because he was a Bedouin, he's not from the city. He started saying, Arsilni, Arsilni, leave me, leave me. Who is it? Who is it? Because he could not see who was hugging him from behind. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cries out in a loud voice, I have a valuable slave with me. Who wants to buy this slave from me? Who wants to buy this slave from me? The sense of humor, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who wants to buy this slave from me? Zahir radiallahu anhu still could not recognize who was behind him, and then he turns, Allahu Akbar. He feels the softness of the palm of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then there is this electrifying moment, that rush of adrenaline that went through him the minute he recognized Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hugging him from behind in the middle of the marketplace. The minute he recognized Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he let his body go loose and he fell onto the back, in the sense, onto the chest of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, enjoying the hug of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he, Zahir radiallahu anhu, states, Ya Rasulullah, I am an ugly person. I don't have any social standing. I am a poor person. You will never fetch a good price for me. You can't market me. I'm not a person who can be marketed because I am a poor, destitute person. And then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you know what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states, O Zahir, you may think of yourself as not valuable. You may think of yourself as unmarketable. But in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are extremely valuable. You are extremely precious, Allah. You are extremely valuable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you are extremely precious in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the sunnah of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, at times we shun people who love us sincerely because we see someone who is of a high social standing, who has wealth, who is famous. At times to greet him and at times to meet him, we shun away people who are poor, who are destitute, and at times who are needy, or at times who don't have a social standing, but they love us sincerely from the bottom of their hearts. And at times the people we rush to go and meet, those people, those famous people, those powerful people, at times they just ignore us. They ignore us. And we ignore the people who love us sincerely. Allahu Akbar. We ignore them. And we give them a cold shoulder because we prefer to rub shoulders with the rich and the famous. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in used to describe Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as mutawasil al-huzn. Da'imat tabassum. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in used to describe Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a man who used to be in perpetual sadness. He used to be in perpetual grief, but whenever you looked at him, he had this beautiful smile on his face. Allahu Akbar. Why perpetual grief? Why perpetual sadness? He was worried about his own ummah. He was worried about you and I, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. His only lament, his only cry was, Ya Ummati, Ya Ummati, Ya Ummati. This was his only worry. He was not worried about his family. He was not worried about his loved ones. He was worried about his ummah. We are his ummah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So likewise, when we look around today and when we see all of these calamities, all of these trials, misfortunes, yes, I know, we have to be sad. We have to grieve. Let us also be sad. Let us grieve. But let us not lose that cheerful smile on our faces. Let us not become victims of a psychological defeat. Because this ummah is an ummah for glory. This ummah, victory has been sealed for this ummah. So never lose hope. Never despair. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. لا تحزن إن الله معنا. لا تحزن إن الله معنا. لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Do not worry. Indeed, Allah is with us. Do not lose hope. Indeed, Allah is with us. Do not despair. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is with us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He the Almighty alleviate the sufferings the Muslim Ummah is going through. May He the Almighty forgive all of our sins and accept all of our good deeds. And just as how He united us here this beautiful afternoon, may He the Almighty unite us.